Good afternoon. Thanks for being having me here. Bit of a question. Whom of you is designer? Good. And whom of you is more on the engineering side? That's going to be a bit of both. The story of today is basically from doing the things right to doing the right things. And I think for me, it's the same as stating from agile to design thinking. I think the true value is in agile is that you do the things right. And if you're not careful, you do the wrong things right. And you know, we are a master in that. And that's why I came and have the experience with you today. In order to do so, I'm going to start basically rounding back a bit of the time. And I'm going to a bit of explain what happened to ING and why did we make the change. Oh, I'll intro myself a bit. I'm the CIO in the Netherlands. ING is a large bank, one of the larger banks in Europe. We serve in Asia as well, in Australia, in Thailand. And you know, it's a typical large monster. And then about 7-8 years ago, we were quite challenged. And why were we challenged? We were challenged because our IT projects basically very often failed. And you know, and if we would be the only one, then it would be okay. But it was a bit of an industry problem. And we saw a lot of failure. And the question is, why do we see all that failure? And I thought, let's start with a bit of an explanation on how ING worked, that you get a bit of a flavor of what happened. So imagine what happened 7, 8, 10 years ago. You want to do a new mortgage system. So what do you do if you want a new mortgage system? And you know, mortgage systems are complex. Eh? You have 30 years of mortgages in these systems. You make a business case. And with a business case, you go to the board of the bank. And these business cases, they work really, really fantastic. In PowerPoint, consistent font sizes. You know, the fonts were great. Everything was nicely aligned. And basically, we always made two big promises. And the first promise is, if you give us this money for this new mortgage system, our revenues will explode. And the second promise was, our cost will implode. Well, who's against those two promises? And basically, you go to the board, and the board, they don't believe half of what you say on the revenues, and they don't believe half of what you say on the cost. But if they take out half on both sides, still NPV-wise, it makes sense. But the problem is, they have a totally different question. They only have one question. And the simple question is, why do you think you can manage it this time? That is going to work this time, after the failures of the last years. And then we always had a very good convincing story. We have a new project director. His name is Peter Jacobs. This guy is fantastic. He has been doing projects for his entire life. He has never failed a project. You know, execution is his middle name. Look at the suit he's wearing. It's just unbelievable. With this guy, it will not fail. And everyone understood that is big, big nonsense. But how often can you say no? Eh? You can't say no forever. So basically, you see what a board of a bank does. They say, okay, you're allowed to do it. But this time, we want to be in full control. Control is his second middle name. No worries. And we'll do it very structured. We'll apply a process that is so structured that we will not do before we think. Yes, we will set us up in very strict phases. And we call this the waterfall model. And the first step is that we come up with all kind of requirements. And then we continue from there. And we will not continue until everything is perfect. Well, doesn't that sound great to an executive? It does. But what happens? On Monday, Peter Jacobs starts, and he's the project director for the project. And what he does, he hires 4 project managers. And the 4 project managers, they come and they start. And what is the first thing they do on Monday morning? They go to the intranet website and they are going to look, how do I become a project director? And the HR website. Because they're only project managers. And what does the HR website say? The HR website says, to become a project director, you need to manage people. So they know, I have to manage people. So they all recruit 4 guys. So at the end of the first day, we don't have one Peter Jacobs, but we have a nice Christmas tree of about 20 guys who are going to make this project succeed. And then day 2 starts. And in day 2, they have the kickoff of their project. And then they make the biggest mistake you can make. This is real life. So what they do is they give the project a name. And the name they give the project is Globe. I can tell you, everyone who calls this project Globe should have been fired on the same day, because you're overscoping from the start. Eh? Your name is already overscoping. So basically, what do? You go to your commercial colleagues, and you say to your commercial colleagues, you say, we've got the money, we're allowed to make this happen. But we're going to do this very structured. And the first 3 months, we're going to do a requirement analysis. We're going to ask you, what do you actually need? And then the commercial guys make the biggest mistake in their life. They think this might actually work. And why is that such a mistake? Because they ask the question, if in 3 years we are ready with the commercial launch of this fantastic new system, will there still be money for me? And the honest answer is no. No, after 3 years mortgages, we're going to spend it on savings or we're going to spend it somewhere else. So this is basically your shot. And what the guys know is I better ensure that all requirements known to mankind are going to be put on the wagon. Yeah, because this is the time for mortgages, so it's going to be all requirements that you can ever think of are going to be put over there. So for months and months and months, the smart people in Amsterdam, the ING internal staff is coming up with all kind of requirements, gigabytes in requirements in PowerPoint, and then the day that finally arises when someone presses on submit because everything is shipped to India. Let's hope for the best. Then it comes over here to a group of people, the size of this team, about 400 people, something like that. They don't know what Netherlands is. They've never heard of Amsterdam. They don't know what banking in the Netherlands is. Mortgages, no clue. ING, never heard of what ING is. Looking at all these requirements and thinking, what the, okay, let's start. And but basically, the project is going quite well. So we report on progress, and we have 20%, and we have 40%, and we have 60%, and we have 80% completed. The executive board finally really pleased. We have 90% completed of the project. 91% is completed. 91.1% is completed. 91.11% is completed. Because we received the first CD-ROMs coming back, you know, and we don't get it integrated, and this is not what we wanted, and our competitors have taken a total different route, and is this what we needed? And basically, we're in deep trouble. And what do? If you're in deep trouble, you fire Peter. Yeah? You don't fire him, but you circle him to another project, and you get the other project manager who's also in a difficult situation. You get him over to your project. And basically, then you find a young guy, 30 years old, who with his young kids out of Amsterdam is going to move to India because he's going to rescue the project among 400 people who have tried to do the utmost to get code working but still don't understand how the Dutch tax law works with all these collaterals and fiscal regulation on mortgages. And how could they even? Until someone is so proud that, I would say that he has the guts after 6 or 9 months later to pull the plug and yet another project failed. Tens of millions down the drain. No code in production. And then, you know, we start all over. And the problem is, you know, if the problem is stupid people like Peter Jacobs or the entire ING staff, you know, it's simple because you could try to replace them. But, you know, we have the good educational systems, we have bright people, they're ambitious, so it can't be that. And it's not that the other industries in IT do such a big thing. So basically, it all came down that we understood our way of working is not good. And this is the rationale for the change. The rationale for the change 7, 8 years ago, let's change the way of working. And why? Because this entire concept of waterfall, this entire concept of first think, then do, then test, then deliver, that is by far the best way of making software. If you can meet 3 simple conditions. 1, you know upfront what you want. 2, engineers know upfront how to build it. And 3, the world doesn't change while you're doing this. And I think that if we look at our language, from architects to blueprints, to we see that we've borrowed the entire way of thinking, our own vocabulary is all borrowed from the civil engineering, yeah? From the other engineering fields. And now let's look at the city of Bangalore. If they build a bridge over a river, they know up front what they want. I have 2 lanes here, I need 2 lanes there. An engineer knows how to build a bridge, and the most beautiful thing for them is that the river doesn't change its course while they're building the bridge. And if you look at the mortgage system, none of the 3 are true. And luckily, you know, we saw that the market changed and Agile was introduced. So then for those, that was basically the focus on doing the right things, and we'll get a bit further on the road. What are the Agile promises and beliefs? I'll tell you what Agile is. Agile is, and I don't know, in India, if I look around, I don't think it's the same, but in Europe, Agile means having a beard and a cap, and having soccer tables, and being cool with cool furniture. Yeah? That's at least step 1 that you have to take. Yeah? Yeah? So that's why I took my suit. I thought today I'll do the opposite. Yeah? So, but at least that's 1. That's Agile. No, and agile is basically, what is agile? I think that whatever you do in life, if you've never done agile, or you want to do it, or you want to do it more, zoom out of the practices and start to understand the principles and even the beliefs. Yeah? And what are now the two biggest beliefs for me? I think that there are three, but they're the most relevant. Let's come one by one. The first and far most important one is the top left one, no handovers. Basically, if you look at Henry Ford with his assembly pipeline, the guy who created all these nice cars for us, he created the assembly pipeline and was able to scale out his production facilities. Since then, this entire concept of an assembly pipeline has been introduced, even to banks. From the marketing division, to the design division, to the engineering division, to the test division, to the QA division. And we basically have an invisible assembly pipeline where we are handing over stuff. And handing over is very cool and good for repetitive processes. If you go to the Kingfisher or the Heineken breweries, you will expect an assembly line filling bottles of beer. But if you make software, which is not a repetitive process, you will see that in these handovers, you constantly have to guarantee that the next guy does not, basically, that he does not fail in meeting what you intended. So you write more documents than you know, everyone who knows CMMI knows that it's one big document misery. But the only thing you do is try not to break down what the guy next to you should be able to do. So kill all handovers. Handovers are wrong. Basically, make people sit together, give them an end-to-end responsibility. The second one is, don't focus on what you want to have in 3 years. Don't focus on the mortgage, what you want to have in 3 years, but focus on what is the earliest that they would like to bring to production. What is my minimum viable product? And minimum viable product does not mean, let's do the functionality and forget the security. Eh? Minimum viable pyramid is not that we have a pyramid where we take the top, but a minimum viable product is a slice. So for example, when ING launched its mobile app, we just started with the current account. To be honest, in terms of functionality and non-functionalities, especially non-functionals, they were perfect. So we worked really our best to make it really perfect. But we had no savings, we had no investments, we had nothing. No mortgages, nothing. And then basically after 6 weeks, we introduced the next slice. And slice by slice, you basically build out. And why do people in the waterfall go for the maximum viable product? Are those people stupid? No. But it's very much also driven by funding. Eh? You fund the change of mortgages. So the entire discussion, this is my time. Now it's my turn. I get now 3 years in which I get to invest. And basically also because people know that that impact will come in 3 years, they better ensure that everything what they potentially could need in 3 years is in the, on that wagon. So people don't dare to go for minimum viable. If you basically say, whatever it takes, I will invest 6 teams in mortgages for the next 200 years, then people get relaxed because the budget is not gone, the people are not gone, they can come in a flow and really try to build this further. I think individuals over individual interactions over processes and tools. So I think that we over invested in all kind of IT support tools, and I think that just having the open debate, you know, you've all seen how much we struggled to get even the Beamer up and running, so we should be careful with all the tools and helping that. I think just the debate, giving people a phone call and a whiteboard help. I think working software, code counts. Code counts is an important one. Eh? You know, you don't get impact with a PowerPoint. You get impact with code. And customer collaboration, I'll come to that, especially, of course, this is, you know, the entire design thinking concept and listening to the gentleman from Walmart, and he really inspired me today, this morning. I'm glad that I did not put user in there, but it's, you know, customer feels like human, so that's at least better. And responding to change, and always keep on changing. So these are a bit of the agile beliefs. Very simple words, small teams, no handovers, focus on what you need next week and not next year. So that was the primary pillar of what we wanted to do in ING. It's simple, many people want to do it. We didn't invent anything, by the way. We just copied, we bought the book, read the book, and said, let's do it. But then we felt there were a couple of impediments, and one by one, I will go through the impediments. The first impediment that we felt was basically we had zero automation in our IT. Zero automation in the way we make software. If you have zero automation in the way you make software, you're in deep trouble. I'll give you one example that we had. We have a core banking system. Imagine piece of software, the core bank, with all the accounts. And it's a US-owned company who sells it to us, and we basically got 5 releases per year. And then you ask the guys, how much time does it cost to, if you get a new release, to actually test it and to implement it on test environments. And then basically the people said, yeah, that cost us a full team about 11 days. And then you think, you know, I'm so glad that agile sprints are 14 days, because at least 3 days are left in which we can do the design thinking and the development and everything, because it takes 11 days to test before we can actually go to production. And of course, everyone started to laugh a bit because it's total nonsense. You have to start automating your pipeline. This is all about zero-touch deployment, and I know that there have been courses last week on the same topic. This is all about decent software versioning systems where you put all your configurations in, so also your deployment scripts, your infra settings, everything should be version controlled. All your tests need to be automated, and this has brought us a lot. So basically, we went from a couple of hundred changes per year, you know, those change weekends with these monstrous changes where everyone, even the CEO, has his mobile phone next to his bed. He's informed by SMS twice or three times a day over how the change weekend is progressing. On Monday morning, cake for everyone because of the big success. At lunch, you see the first failures and no one talks about them. At 4 o'clock, there are so many failures that no one cannot talk about them, those kind of weekends. So basically, we saw the solution in this book called Continuous Delivery. Continuous Delivery is a fantastic book for everyone who does IT. And it's a couple of years old, and now we would even go further in the world of immutable containers, and especially the world of mutables for us, very important. But to read this book, this has helped us tremendously. So today in ING, 20,000-30,000 changes per month, and everything is being automated. Build the flow, build the flow. Build the ability to experiment with software. The third one is we copied the governance model. We needed a new governance model. This is an org chart, and we basically copied Spotify's org chart. Normally, when I talk to executives, they are very, very interested in org charts, and managers like to talk about org charts and governance. For me, it's of the four pillars, it's the least interesting one, but at least we copied one, and you could take anyone. We took the Spotify model. And then the last one, and I think this is the most important one. The most important one is if you go agile, in an agile world, you're with small teams, and these small teams, 5-6 developers, but with us, all the business people are in there. There is no one outside such a small team. So the guy, the teams for us, they do the development and the operation. They do the prior one incidents in the weekends, but they also do the design thinking. The entire team does everything. No handovers. So basically, it means that you have 5-6 developers max. You have 3-4 guys doing marketing and product management and channel optimization. So all the commercial guys and the IT guys together in a group of 9 making this happen. What do you get? You get job broadening. You know, we come from a world where we have very narrow jobs in the waterfall period and we go to very larger jobs. If you go to larger jobs, you need better people, people who can do that. So I think that there is a tremendous, tremendous focus on talent. Talent, talent, talent. We come from a world where IT guys were offered as resources, almost by the volume. If you take 100, you get a discount of 10, that kind of discussions. And I think that we have 100% appreciated that that is a lousy model. I think ING only, we are only looking for talent. And I think that's, you know, the productivity of talent is so much higher. You see that we at ING apply a productivity metric of 1 to 8 between a novice and an expert. In Harvard Business Review, we read a lot of articles about 1 to 64. So basically, and this entire concept of drivers, we copied this from Netflix. And the two brothers drivers, they were basically university professors in California, having the observable behaviors on the quality of people. I think it's extremely interesting for everyone in IT to understand what is your view on talent, how do you grow talent, how do you reward it, and how do you get out of the situation that basically you're looking at large volumes without too much impact. Great people have an amazing impact. So those are basically the four elements that we had. And you see that today we are at a level that's even a bit further. When we started 3-4 years ago, we said, we don't want this pyramid anymore with a few expensive guys per hour that are extremely productive, but that we forget, and we compare them with less expensive guys at the bottom, and therefore less expensive is good to any CFO. That model should change. The pyramid does not deliver anything. We want to go for a diamond structure. You see the novice about 5%, advanced beginner 25%, competent 55%, proficient 1%, and expert 5%. And experts should be guys who write books and who are known in the field of technologies, whether it's Kafka or Nginx or Polymer or whatever you do, Pega or I don't care what you do, but at least you have to be known in order to get there. And you see that talent attracts talent, so therefore we are growing more and more to the upper side. And in all our partnerships, also with our Indian colleagues, the only thing we care about is talent. People who work themselves and who have the full ownership, they don't hand over. We shall never have an external not producing code and bring that to production. And so talent is the one key thing. So these are the four things. So overall, now the question is, what did it bring? If you look, and there are many, many movies and many sessions and many debates, and there are many discussions about what makes people stay at a company. You most likely all work for a company or you're self-employed, but let's, for those who work at a company, ask yourself the question, why do I stay? And I think that for everyone who basically stays, we came to the conclusion that there are three big drivers for you to remain part of a family, and that is the autonomy, that is the craftsmanship, and that is the purpose. And now let's see, if you compare ING 10 years ago with ING today, to what extent do we see a shift? I think that there is a tremendous shift in autonomy. I think that the agile mentality has pushed for great levels of autonomy. That the reason is we make teams independent and they can together decide on how they do it and make it happen. And the impact is also theirs. If you are a tester and you have done 4 days of testing on the new mobile solution, and then after 16 weeks it goes live together with some other large complex changes, do you still feel that this is your product? I think that's the, so basically, I think that the autonomy, the levels of which you can do it, it has gone up quite well. If you look at craftsmanship, you see that in ING, if you don't produce code, you are support, and we don't need that much support. So I understand that I'm supporting 2 engineers. So basically, in normal companies, you would have, you start as an engineer, you become an architect, and you grow to become a manager. Eh? And that is basically, if you didn't make that in 5 years, then your wife might say, it's not going well. Eh? You know, how can I help? That kind of discussions. But I think that these days in ING, it's a bit different. Eh? So basically, you know, the guys at the top are the engineers, and they're supported by architects. And if you're really a loser, you become the CIO. Right? A bit of an. So basically, I think that the respect for craftsmanship is enormous, and it's going enormous. But to be honest, in terms of purpose, agile does not help that much. If you're really honest, I think that there are some downsides of agile that are not related to your maturity, but related to the way agile works. Agile is so keen on minimum viable products that if you're not careful, these autonomous teams will come with incremental innovations. They will remain incremental, and you will see that the orange color of ING on the button might change every 6 prints with 2 pixels, or I don't know, with 2 RGB colors. So I think the risk of agile is a bit that if you don't organize it well, one risk is that you basically see that you become incremental in your innovation. And the other risk is that this autonomy, at least at large scale, we have hundreds of agile teams, that they basically spread out. And if you're not careful, in 6 months, we would have opened a restaurant, you know, because people drift towards a purpose that has no relation anymore with a kind of a corporate strategy. So how do you deal with that? How do you bring purpose and alignment to basically mitigate the intrinsic risk of minimum viable products focusing on incremental innovations and a lot of autonomy taking you potentially to a course that is not what you want to do? That's a bit of the challenge that I think that is our challenge and that we're addressing these days. And that's where we make the shift basically from doing the things right, the agile, to doing the right things, which is perhaps even more important. So let's see how we do that. We basically have 3 blocks on which we focus. The number one is the QBR, the number two is design thinking, and number three is the OBEA. I'll go one by one, and I'll hope that I'll bring you basically a bit further. On the QBR is first a very important one. Again, we copy this from another, so you see ING doesn't invent anything. You basically get the knowledge of many companies by one guy. But basically, what did we do? In the QBR, so how does it work? We want basically alignment in our strategy. So what does the board do? I'll go to the first one. What do we do as a board? We basically ask people for a quarterly business review. And many of you might have used the same term, but perhaps for a different process. So let me explain you how we do it now at ING. Basically, we say a month before the quarter starts, so T minus 30, we as a board in ING present to all colleagues, basically, what are now the key priorities on the entire board level. So it could be about asset growth, it could be about liabilities, it could be about primary accounts, it could be about IT risk, it could be about compliance. There can be many, many key topics, and we try to come up with the key topics. And the way we do that, and I think, is we want to express basically what is the impact that we want to see in 12 months. So not what are the activities we hope to do next, which is also cool, but it's irrelevant. Not what capabilities we want to build, so not the activities, not the capabilities, but the impact. So we try to come up with a photo that basically states, if we would fast forward time in 12 months, this is what we would like to see on the photo in terms of impact. You know, we want to see at least a growth of 1 million primary customers. We want to see that the market share in savings goes from 6% to 9%. I don't know, this is impact. So what we then do is we have these departments in this Spotify organizational model. A department with a purpose is called a tribe. And the tribe basically is the end-to-end delivering the purpose. So we have a mortgages tribe, we have a security tribe, we have an, you know, we have different tribes for the different components of the bank. And they're all groups of a couple of hundred people. And then we ask the tribe leaders, guys, you've understood our priorities. So at T-minus 30, we want to give you 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 20 days, something like that, to now individually, you as a tribe, we would like you to come up with your QBR documents. And in your QBR document, we have some very strict rules. Number one, we would like you to write that in Microsoft Word, because we feel that PowerPoint is potentially a bit too fluffy. We want to see it basically in text. And in text, we would like you to answer 3 basic questions. What was the impact that you realized as a mortgage tribe over the last 3 months? What is the impact that you will deliver in the next 12? And what is the impact that you are going to do in the next 3? So from 12 back to 3. So then at team, so the teams are for 3 weeks together working with that, and they get a page budget. A page budget basically means you write it in 6 pages. If it's more, we won't allow it, because if you need more than 6 pages to answer 3 questions, then your answers must be fluffy. Yeah? So basically, and otherwise it becomes too much to read and you don't get the rhythm in. So basically what you do, 10, 15 of those tribes, at T minus 10, they all publish it at a kind of a SharePoint, and the SharePoint is open for commenting. So they start to comment. So after a period of 20 days where they, from the bottom, with all the power of their craftsmanship, have been writing together what they want to do, all of a sudden the tribes start to basically see each other's documents, and they start to online comment and online reply on those documents, and we as a board do the same. And basically it's very often, it's either questions, I don't understand what you mean, but it could also mean message, hey, I thought we agreed you would do this because I'm hoping that if you have that, I can build on it and go further. So that's the kind of dependency. You see horizontal alignment taking place. And then we go, and that happens for 10 days, and then at T is T, we basically have the QBR day, and at the QBR day, we basically have this kind of carousel where people can try to overcome the unresolved challenges. After they've done that, then we have, as a board, have seen what are the independent strategies. We have basically seen what are the dependencies that have to be resolved. And then what we do is we allocate budget. And budget allocation is no longer anymore about projects. No, it's basically agile teams are like Lego. They're about, you know, 10 people each. So you can all figure out how expensive they are. And we divide the teams over the different tribes. We say based on the commercial strategy, based on our competition, based on this, we allocate 4 teams from mortgages to securities. And that can only happen if you have great guys who can learn basically how securities work. So therefore, once more, you see that the roles of IT, especially IT people, we don't look at what technology you have, whether it's Angular or Polymer or Kafka or Flink or whatever you do, Java or Scala, or APL, it's a language I have to read over the weekend. I've been influenced. But basically, these kind of, it doesn't matter what you do. We want great people to make great software. So this is how we cascade as an organization and how we try to get consistency in a kind of a corporate strategy towards how the teams see the objectives and materialize this themselves. Then we go to the second one, and the second one is, it's for me, it's about design thinking. Design thinking, it's magic, and I learned a lot today because I'm a nerd, I'm not a design thinker, I'm just a software guy. But I start to learn more and more and more. The one thing that, you know, I'm not trying to preach to people who know much more about the topic than I do, But what I would like to give to the people who do IT is, if you look at the risk of agile, that you are always continuation your existing path, and at least what design thinking has learned us is that you first have to broaden out, you have to go really broad, you have to divert basically before you converge. So this kind of the fact that you, in order to rethink what shall we do next, that you strict it, that you're very tough to yourself, that you don't basically continue with what you had, but start to rethink about what could I have been doing and what is now serving the purpose, I think makes an immense sense. So you have the objective in your QBR, and instead of just continuation, you go broad before you converge to a root. And the second one, I think that this was published, I think, 20 years ago already, on design thinking. There are the four big principles of design thinking that I like most, and I will never basically forget them. So design thinking for me, it's human-centered. Human-centered is the most important thing there is. So it's the personas, it's the entire philosophy of what does it do with an end customer, and basically how does the flow work for this end customer. So making a human-centered design, I think especially in the digital services sector where we as a bank are, it's very, very important. The second one is ambiguity. Try to really ensure that you see all the concepts from left to right. Don't follow the obvious. Doing the obvious has made us fail. And I'll give you an example on where we absolutely failed. It's always nicer than the good stories. And then design thinking should be called redesign thinking. The word redesign, as one of the pillars, means you redesign because for some reason you are not happy with what you have today. And making explicit with what you're not happy with is, I think, an extreme strong starting point. And then tangibility, and here you see that design thinking and agile meet, because tangible means code counts. It means build it. Whether, either as a prototype, some of the people together with me today in the Walmart session have been using, the dough and pens and papers, but make it tangible. Tangible is, I think, very, very important. That's for design thinkers and that's for engineers. You build it and then test it and see it. So I think that is a very, very important topic. But I promised you that I'll show you a failure. We had a fantastic, fantastic proposition. A fantastic proposition. I won't go into detail because it's a bit too complex and too Dutch, but it was basically an easy way to do payments. And an easy way to do payments triggered by a web shop. A web shop can trigger you to do payments without a credit card, a bit of a PayPal-like thing. And then someone in our organization came up with the idea, if we as a bank would portray ourselves as a company selling money, and we would allow our customers to put the products in our shop, it's all a bit complex, but then we can use this technical route for people to send a WhatsApp to a friend with a payment request, as if Amazon would do a payment request for a book. And you send the payment request, and you pay that payment request to the bank, and then we'll bring that back to the actual customer who owns it. So we basically had the negative payment, which is extremely easy. If you go and have drinks and food and whatever you do, you can just send a WhatsApp to your friend. If you have a WhatsApp group, you send one WhatsApp, and 9 people get the payment request, they press on the button, and the money is at the receiving end. It was great, and it utterly failed. Why? Our competitor saw it, and after 3 weeks decided, why would I only offer this to my existing customers, not to the Dutch society? So basically, they published it not for their customers, but for the Dutch society. They gave it a bit of a better brand name. They called it Tikkie. And now Tikkie has become the Dutch word for payment requests, like you have Xerox in the US for copying. And basically, it was our total lack of smart enough to understand that ambiguity and going diverse and questioning yourself and don't go too fast to the convergence, the fact that we did not do it properly, the design thinking, well, the competition teach you how to do it better. So at least it makes you aware that next time you do it. So it's for us very, very important. Then the third one is that design thinking, and I think also in the session we just saw from BBVA, it starts with the redesign, understanding what needs to be redesigned. Why should you redesign something? You can only redesign something if you know where you stand. And I think that for us, it has resulted in this concept of Obeya rooms, and that came from Japan. And Obeya room is basically a kind of a war room where you basically use all four walls. And in these, you know, I'll show you both the structure and the process. What you do on a weekly basis, the entire core team, 20 or 30 people, come into a physical room. And on the physical room, on the left side, you see the performance. And the performance wall is extremely relevant. There you show impact. So in mortgages, you might expect market share, you might expect true impact. Impact on customer satisfaction, basically what you want to see. That's impact. And then you go to the portfolio wall on the other side, discussing basically, what are we doing in terms of our epics in order to improve on what we do there? You initiate basically your design thinking flow because you have to define there what you want to redesign. And then that leads into some action boards. That's just for managers who also need to do something. They get the impediments that they can clean out. And this basically, this turnaround then takes place. And what I like best in large organizations like ING, we do that on a cascaded thing. Because if there are impediments that we can't resolve, we go one level up. And the overall performance of our entire board on the lower level becomes one line or one chart in the one level up. So you get this cascaded point of view. And if you do it nicely, and that's what we're trying to do now, you'll basically see that you can do that in a couple of hours. So from 9 to 10, all tribes have their independent Obeya session. Then from 10 to 10:30, all the impediments and the progress and the reports are brought up. And for example, from 11 to 12, we as a management team, as a board of the bank, have then our Obeya session. Then all the impediments are resolved. And before it's lunch, hopefully the organization knows how we basically took the decisions and where we helped the organization to mature. So a long story short, I think that ING has done a lot to improve its way of working, doing the things right. Agile has helped us tremendously. In order to become agile, we focus on continuous delivery. We focused on basically the Spotify governance model. And we've introduced a real talent model. That's all to become agile. And then we understood that you might be doing the wrong things very right. That's not a situation where you want to be in. So you have to focus more on doing the right things. And that's for us basically getting a cascaded perspective on how to get strategy down. That's ensuring that whenever you start something new, that you apply the design thinking with its four principles in terms of making sure that you do the right things, and that is measuring progress, discussing progress, and getting the impediments out. That was the discussion for today. But I'm more than open to questions. I don't know how I'm doing in terms of time, but... So let's see. Four more minutes. That's nicely. Questions. Good.